Who am I?
Richard Casimer, media veteran.
Why I got in radio is because I'm good with a knife.
Contributor in Perth, Australia.
Our friend Richard Casimer in the United States.
How are you guys enjoying the 19th century? Is that working out for you? How can you say, I'm not making fun of you as a race, I'm making fun of you as black performers?
I think as a country, Americans are as patriotic as the most rabid UK football hooligan.
Who am I?
Richard S. Casimer.
What's really going on with Phil Dobby? Dobby.
Hello. It is Balls Radio, and you know you can't meet the Dalai Lama these days without upsetting the Chinese. I don't meet him anymore. Look, I have to say, I'm sorry, His Holiness, or whatever you want to be called. You know, I just don't want to upset the Chinese. So, because they really don't like him over there. They reckon he used violent methods to establish an independent Tibet. Find it hard to see. He seems such a nice bloke, doesn't he? But they reckon he's not the peaceful, charismatic man that we all see. Because, of course, you can bluff charisma. And if you want the proof, here's Richard Casimer in the United States. So Obama has been meeting the Dalai Lama, not for the first time, I don't think. But have many other U.S. presidents met him?
You know, I'm not sure on that. He may have met with Clinton. I don't think he's met with Reagan or G.W. Bush. I'm not sure. I don't follow His Holiness's travels. But he was here last Friday and met with the president. Very low-key meeting. No one saw him come in or leave the White House. That was closed to the press, closed to everyone. And what we surmise their talks were about, since President Obama is really not for Tibet regaining its independence from China, they probably talked about humanitarian efforts and things like that. But, and also the other thing is that what they have in common is that both are Nobel laureates. Mm. So it's not like the Dalai Lama would ever be meeting with a Republican here in Washington. So there is that. But, I mean, how can you not like the Dalai Lama? The guy is like a rock star. He's like a cross between Buddha and Dame Edna. Yeah. You know, how do you not like
him? Well, I think, have you ever seen him talk? I haven't, but I know people who've been to see him and they just say, yep, you know, the man is just wise beyond, beyond anybody ever. And you just leave just feeling as though your soul has been fulfilled.
Exactly. And Obama is a very spiritual man. There's been a lot of criticism, especially from the right, and especially from the Christian fundamentalists who accuse him of being everything from the devil incarnate. They call him the One. The Christian fundamentalists call him the One, which is their reference to the devil. But Christians know the One as Jesus or God. So
who are they calling the One? Barack or the Dalai Lama?
Barack Obama.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
So for him, and there's always the thing that he's a Muslim, which he's not. He's a Christian.
Yeah.
So when he meets with a holy person like the Dalai Lama, it's pretty much ignored in the press, except to say Obama is putting his thumb in the eye of China, which is against this. China came out and said that any meeting with the Dalai Lama that the president has is going to seriously damage China's ties with Washington. And of course, Obama seriously doubts the seriousness of China's serious concern and met with him anyway.
Well, they always seem to get over it. I mean, John Howard over here met with the Dalai Lama. And Kevin Rudd did. Interestingly, Kevin Rudd did before he was PM. When he was PM and the Dalai Lama was over, Kevin Rudd strangely had a diary clash, was his excuse for not meeting him. Can you imagine the Dalai Lama's over going, oh, look, I can't, 10 o'clock now, sorry. Yeah, no, got a gym appointment or getting my hair done or something. Or got to see the optometrist. I've been trying all week. You would just find time. So diary, not meeting him is one thing and saying, oh, look, it's going to upset the Chinese, so we're not going to meet him. But actually saying a diary clash is just a bit insulting, isn't it?
I think this is one of those deals where no matter what your religious conviction or lack thereof, maybe you don't want to take a chance and you do want to meet with the Pope and meet with the Dalai Lama and anybody else who comes down the pike just as a courtesy.
Yeah, you would have thought so. Now, moving on, California. A plan to split it into six separate states, or at least this is an idea which is being put forward by a guy called Tim Draper. Who the hell is Tim Draper? Is he Don Draper's brother, is he?
This is never going to happen. Tim Draper is a venture capitalist. He owns an investment firm called Draper, Fisher & Jurvetson. And so anytime you see a venture capitalist,
is he Don Draper's brother? I mean, it sounds like it's either a venture capitalist or an ad agency with a name like that, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, that's pretty much it. You know, it's gotten enough signatures to initially get on the ballot in November, but it's just not going to happen. What his premise is that California is so big that he's proposing or advocating that it's ungovernable, and the only way that you can realistically and more effectively govern the entire state is to break it up into sections. What his beef is that places that produce a lot of money, like Silicon Valley, are paying taxes to other areas of California that are not income producing or revenue generating. So it's unfair. So he's proposing that if these six communities or six would be new states in the United States would be developed, therefore each of these new states would govern themselves. But what it also does is it creates six new forms of government, new senators, Congress people, and so on. And it is not going to happen.
More jobs for the boys. But what a beautiful rationale, saying, yeah, we've got some places where the money's created. Let's keep all the money there. And then we've got other states that can be created, which will just be bankrupt from the day they're born.
But this is the problem. And this is where you separate capitalist from either politicians or advocates and socialists and people like that, that you can't run a country like a business. So, you know, maybe his intentions are good and the concept is there, but as soon as you start running people like a business and making your citizens employees of that business, i.e. government, it's not going to work. That's not what the Constitution was about. That's not what our founding fathers wanted. On paper, it may look good, but realistically, it doesn't work.
Yeah, that's right. And yet all around the world, politicians are always saying, yes, I'm going to run this country like a business. And so many people say, yep, that's exactly how we want it to be run. And yet then they say, well, look, we're not going to do things that businesses do, like we won't take in debt because debt's a bad thing, even though businesses run off it. And secondly, you can't let people leave a country. You know, you can fire people from a business, but you can't go, I'm sorry, you have to leave the country now. We've got too many people. You're upsetting our employment figures. You're upsetting our bottom line. So, I mean, it's crazy, the idea that you could. But anyway, it's still a myth perpetuated by many people. Now, a place that's certainly not been run like a business, Detroit. There's plans, I think, to try and get it back onto its feet. But what's the status now? What is happening there?
It is bankrupt. The entire city has gone bankrupt due to the usual reasons that a large city goes bankrupt: years and years of corporate greed, of corruption, organized crime, you name it, mismanagement. That's why Detroit has gone bankrupt. People on the left are saying that, well, you know, this is a Republican governor purposely did this to default on pensions for teachers and fire people and police and things like that. Unions, getting rid of the unions, defaulting on payment of those, making them have concessions for their wages in the future, eliminating unions altogether. And that it's a master plan. So we'll see where that goes. But right now, Detroit is bankrupt. The outlook doesn't look good for the foreseeable future, but we'll see what happens. It's a very resilient city, one of the most important cities in this country, one of the oldest cities in this country, as far as the industry is concerned. So we'll see where it goes.
Have they actually got a roadmap, though, to try and get it back on its feet?
Yes, it's a little sketchy right now, but what the layout looks like is exactly what I was mentioning, and what is so disconcerting among unions and teachers and people who are the nuts and bolts of any city, the very heart of it, the infrastructure, is that no one will have a say in wages, safety, hours work, your tenure in your job. They're actually selling off the museum. He wants to privatize a lot of let's say fire, police, things like that. Instead of having the city workers do it, that it'll be a privatized company, which again is exactly what is happening all over this country, especially in areas that are controlled by Tea Party Republicans. Is that's what they want to do, is that there's no more free ride. There's no more public dole. If you can't pay your way, you don't get police service. You don't get fire service. Schools will be privatized. If you can't afford to go to school, then you go to work in a factory. You don't deserve to be educated. And that's the frightening thing that's happening all across this country.
Right, so long as you've still got the factories for them to go and work in, of course.
There is that.
Cars obviously still being made there. I mean, the car industry was helped out. I mean, this is an interesting discussion here in Australia, where of course we've decided that we are going to abandon the car manufacturing industry totally in the next few years because of the level of government subsidy. But we're importing from overseas, obviously importing from a lot of countries where the car industry is still subsidized. So is it subsidized in the U.S. or does it stand on its own 2 feet?
It stands on its own 2 feet. There isn't any subsidies for the U.S. auto manufacturers. And I want to back up just a second here, because Detroit's going bankrupt and the auto industry in the United States are two separate things. There are no auto manufacturing plants in Detroit. There haven't been there for over half a century.
No.
They moved out.
My mistake.
But that's the misnomer, and that's the conception, is that Detroit put the wheels on the ground here in this country. And initially, Detroit became Motor City is that back in the day, before there was the internal combustion engine, that's where carriages were made. So they had the infrastructure there to do it, and they just retooled and started making cars. But back in the 50s and even earlier, the car manufacturers knew that it was better to move their plants out into the burbs and the surrounding areas, where there was more areas to expand and a larger workforce and less of a tax burden, than to expand their facilities in the city itself. So that's why they left and went to places like Lansing, Michigan, and Flint, and places like that. And also now there are so many auto manufacturers that are down in the American South, also in the Midwest, Illinois, Ohio, places like that, Tennessee, Kentucky. That's where the plants are, and few are actually in Detroit, and only two are in Detroit itself now, and they look like they're going to be moving out as well.
So, but it's a profitable industry in the United States, or is it struggling like it has been in Australia? Because of course, you know, wages obviously can be a lot lower in the U.S., but you're still competing against Asian wages, obviously, and they can make them a lot cheaper, I would have thought.
Well, thanks to Obama's bailout in 2009 that Chrysler and GM took, Ford did not. The government bailed out these two companies and got them back on their feet, and they retooled, consolidated, upgraded. So the auto industry in the United States is probably the healthiest it's been in 30 years. It is doing extremely well. What you say about competing with the wages of foreign companies, bear in mind that Toyota, Nissan, Hyundai, Mercedes-Benz, Volkswagen, all of those companies are here in the United States. So we're not competing with the Japanese workers. We're competing with Toyota that is being manufactured here in the United States. A lot of the foreign companies that have been over here for many, many years are non-union shops. Not to disparage unions or to say that they were the cause of the failure of the auto industry, but they work at a lower wage, but there are benefits. Volkswagen, for example, down south just offered or had it on the table whether or not the workers wanted to unionize, and the workers turned it down. What they're going to do instead is use the model that the workers have in the factories in Germany, which works very, very well.
Right. And it's always overplayed anyway, this argument about the labor costs for manufacturing a car, because it's still a relatively small part of the total cost. I mean, I'd heard that it's about 10% of the value of a car is the cost in wages, because of course a large part of it is the machinery. And as you said, if you retool and create cars more effectively, that is going to have a big impact, and that's clearly what's happened in the United States. And then obviously the cost of all the parts, so 10% going on the cost of labor seems to be the focus for a lot of people as a good opportunity to union bash. And I think that's what's happened here, you know, whereas it's an incidental cost in some ways. You know, if the wages cost twice as much, if you doubled everyone's wage, then maybe it'd be getting up to 15 or 20% of the value of the car. But conversely, if you halved it, then, you know, you're only affecting 5% of the total cost. So it's not a game changer in that respect.
Well, you also have the difference. What's happening in Australia is that our infrastructure here for the cars, now back in the day when Henry Ford was making cars, from bumper to bumper, roof to tire, was all made within that single factory. Now we have assembly plants, and the parts come from other factories, either in Mexico, within the United States, in Japan, in China, or Canada. Those parts come here and they're put together in the assembly plants. You, as because of your the isolation of Australia as a country and as a continent, everything has to be shipped to you to be put together, and therefore inflates the cost of that car. So it's actually cheaper now for whole cars to be sent to Australia than it is to be assembled in Australia. And I think that's the issue, which again, you know, if the car manufacturers are going to do the suggested retail price, it's not going to be economically feasible for them to send your car if you can't afford the car. So I don't see Australian cars, whether it's a Ford, a Toyota, or anything, going up to the astronomical prices. Otherwise, what are people going to drive? It doesn't make good business sense, whether there's a factory in Australia or not, to try to sell you something that you can't afford. The retailers
we don't need work cars here in Australia anyway. We'll just build big high-rises in the center of towns, and we'll all live and work there, and the rest of the country, just let the sheep roam.
Put a dome on it and some hot meat pies on every table, and I'm there, brother. I'll do it.
All right, good to talk to you, Richard.
All right, Phil.
Richard Kazma in the United States.
Take care.
Radio with Phil Dobby.